George Chasm, and I live here in Timmins for a while. I'd like to share a little bit of what I went through as a residential school survivor. I was in the St. Anne's residential school for 3 years. People say I was there for 4 years, but to me, I think I was there 3 years. And I know that the way my life has been, that I had no parenting skills when I had my children. I wanted to protect them. And when I lived in a shack, I never wanted to drink there because I wanted them to be safe. And then I moved to a house, Ontario Housing, which provided electric heat. And there was rooms there for them, enough rooms for them. And then that's when I allowed people in my home. Before that, I would never allow them in my home because I didn't want my children to get hurt. And I lived in a small shack back then. And to start my story off about how I lack parenting skills, it's because I never had a home to see my mom and dad the way the teachings would be. Back in the day, I had noticed from elders the loving they provided before the residential school. I seen the love that they provided. When they came to my home, they would take our hand and kiss our hand and talk lovingly to us. And that's how it was a very long time ago. That disappeared when I went to residential school, even with my mom. My mother, the loving touch that she would give us, that all disappeared. Just seemed to disappear. It was different after. I went away. I didn't want to go back after 3 years. I went to live out in the railroad tracks where my dad worked. It was good. Life was good there because my father killed moose and fed everybody that was there. And my father would kill other animals like geese and would provide for other families that work on the line. I can tell you many good stories about my life when I was a child growing up with my parents. And my mother provided teachings in Foxville. She teach me how to count. I never lacked in school. When I went to school, they sent me to Toronto. The truant officer came. We said I had to go to school, so they found me a school in Toronto. I didn't have to go back to Fort Albany. And they taught me, the school said I was good in my grades. And that's because my mother taught me. Even though my mother couldn't speak English, she taught me how to do math using sticks, how to add and take away, and I was pretty knowledgeable because of her. She was a good teacher. She taught me other things, traditional. When I went to school in Toronto, I was writing stories. And the teacher would say, come to the front. And I would read my stories. There were stories about life in the North. I was young, a young child. I was about 13 when I was in Toronto. And the teacher encouraged me to share my stories about our life the way it was. Of course, because of all the things that happened in my life, I didn't learn too much about parenting. And it stems too from the residential school, being raised by nuns and having priests involved in my life. just didn't have too much. Same with the other people that went to residential school. I never used Pampers. Always used diapers, right to the last child I had. But I had a lot of food, I'll tell you. My mother taught me how to cook, and life was good at home. My mother taught me a lot of good things, values about life, and I can share that with anybody. Life was like that before, for my other families as well. They had good lives, we had good lives. And I want to share today, things are changing. Things are good. I know back in the, I saw the foundation going up for Sagastel Healing Lodge. I was riding around in the vehicle with my grandchildren, and I told them, Granny's gonna go there. And I pointed at the foundation. They were just building the foundation. And I went there to the Healing Lodge when it was ready. When it was new, I went there and I looked at my life and I changed my life around, because I went into a lot of dysfunction, me too. And I would party, drink, and I would as well as do marijuana. I did all that, which is not a good way to be. But life changed after. I went to the Healing Lodge in 1993, 94, 95. I was working in my life. I went, when I came out of the Sagastel, I told them I still had a barrier that I had to look into. And that was my residential school issue. Even though Sagastel helped me a lot of ways, many ways, I still feel wounded. So I had to find further healing, which I found in Toronto. And the program is called the Hoffman Quaternity Process. And others that I know, people that I know, went to that program as well. And I'm very proud I went there. It teaches about the values about life, about raising children, and the values that we should instill in them. For instance, residential school, there were no hugging. And we need to hug our children and allow them to feel that they are loved. And I did a lot of things. Family, learning to be family. After I went to treatment in 1993, I can tell you that was my last, the dysfunction style that I live. That was the last in 1993. I started living a good life. I went to work at Sagastel Healing Lodge. I also went to work at the Anderson Island, working with families. Anderson Island, I flew out there, it's an isolated place, and working with families and them as well as they should learn about parenting, and that's the program. And then thing happened in my home too as well, just like dysfunction. A lot of things happened in my family, where one of my daughters left her children. So I told my supervisor, well, I'm leaving and I'm gonna go home and take care of my grandchildren. And that's what I did. I left my workplace and then I went home and I raised my grandchildren the right way. I was there for them. They didn't have to go into the system. Many kids end up in the system and they're very unhappy and they're very, very hurt. We try to help them. For some it works, for others They just seem to wander, or we never hear from them. Life is very hard for children that go into the system, because there's no love in the system. A lot of times they are not shown love, and it's very hard. I followed closely with the system, and the children that come home to my place, when I opened my home that time, they could only stay there for emergency. They asked me to keep them, and I said I can't. My home is only for emergency. The only ones I kept were my grandchildren, and then there was three of them. So I couldn't keep other kids on a long-term base. Sorry that it happened like that, but the children would come. After so many years, the children that came to my house remembered. Sometimes they call me. Sometimes they'll talk to me when they see me. They say, "Remember me?" I said, "Yes, I remember you." You know, I like to share that when we meet with kids, that we need to spend time with them. We need to share them. Or people that have been separated from their children and they need help, we should visit them and ask them what they need. Being in a foster home, it's a hard life. I was in different homes when I went to school in Toronto. I never stayed in one home long, no. I stayed in different homes. And I know what it feels like. Never really belonging, but they were good homes. They were good meals. But that was it. And when I think about the children that are the foster children, then I really think that we should all try our best to help them, to really help them. Because if we don't, then they wander off and they end up in drugs. They end up doing things that they shouldn't be doing. And a lot of hurt comes. And I really don't like to see that. The message I have for parents would be like they should spend a lot of time with their children. There are some homes today, the parents don't stay home. The kids are there and the parents don't stay home, and that shouldn't be happening. So I'm encouraging parents, when you get your children back from the society, to spend time with them and to reach out for help. And I would like to tell the parents that they have to concentrate on positive living, to spend time at home with the children. When we meet with kids, that we need to spend time with them. We need to share them. Or people that have been separated from their children and they need help, we should visit them and ask them what they need. Being in a foster home, it's a hard life. I was in different homes when I went to school in Toronto. I never stayed in one home long, no. I stayed in different homes. And I know what it feels like. Never really belonging, but they were good homes. They were good meals. But that was it. And when I think about the children that are the foster children, then I really think that we should all try our best to help them, to really help them. Because if we don't, then they wander off and they end up in drugs. They end up doing things that they shouldn't be doing. And a lot of hurt comes. And I really don't like to see that. some youth programs, and I would like to encourage the youth to interact, to go to these programs, and to approach the workers. If they want to talk to the workers privately, if they have problems, talk to them privately. Is this something that can be done? Sometimes their youth have problems and they have no one to talk to. And this is, I see that over the years. They have no one to talk to. And I just want to encourage them to not hesitate to reach out for help.
When we talk about services that are there for the children, whether our own children or children in care, like, we know that you know, the agency strives to keep children together, but that doesn't always work out. A lot of times it could be for different reasons, like maybe people not knowing how to do that type of work, or having that compassion or empathy. But you know, we see the agency trying to keep children in the communities. You know, we have more foster homes, like receiving homes, I guess, opening in our area, our region. And we talked about earlier how when Mom was younger, she remembers you know, the elders who would visit, how they would just show like affection and love to the children they were visiting. They'd hold their hands, kiss their hands, and hug them. And you know, that had stopped over the years for many different reasons. But we're talking about how that is slowly coming back again. Like, you know, people are aware of getting, or learning, I guess, and becoming more aware of our traditional ways, our cultural ways, and bringing back those things like the affection, the love, and that the children need. You know, sometimes it's through the aunties, the uncles, the grandparents, or foster parents. But we do see it slowly coming back, and which is a good thing for the children, for the families, and yeah.